Welcome to the talk. Manipulating signals, designing filters for signals and voltages yourself by Jakob Lerch. This is.
Hallo und herzlich willkommen.
This talk is being translated into English for you by Caluera and Isegrim. Any feedback is appreciated. Please use the hashtag CSreelingo on Twitter or Mastodon. We hope you enjoyed the talk. Welcome to the topic will be a little more unusual. We are looking into the analog circuit technology. We are looking to annoyed neighbor, the way from the neighbor to a filter which reduces these bass noises. So there will be a Q&A in the end, and if you have questions, please ask them at the end and on Twitter or Mastodon under the hashtag RC3Fem or in the IRC or on the Rocket Chat and
the translated audio stream in the web player. Und nun viel Spaß mit dem Talk. Hallo, mein Name ist Jakob.
Ich And now, have fun with the talk. Hallo, my name is Jakob. I'm studying Engineer Computer Science at the Uni Ilmenau, and I want to talk about how signals are manipulated and at first what are signals and what is manipulating them. So let's start. Please imagine you are having a party and your neighbor is really annoyed because it's that loud and complains, and you should turn off the music because otherwise he will call the police, and you don't want that, but you also don't really want to stop completely. And what would be nice that if these deep frequencies, which you may be hearing when your neighbors are having a party, that's what you can hear especially. So that an idea would be if the low frequencies would be filtered out, then the neighbors would be less annoyed. Might not be that nice, but it's better than turning the music off. So what do we do? We have to put something between the microphone and the speaker, so the signal. So when we are doing that, the neighbor is happy, and we are also happy, and we can continue our party. That's the aim of this talk. That's we want to know how a signal looks and how can we manipulate it. So at first, I will talk about what is a signal and special audio signal, where the audio signal is motivation. Then I will talk about how you manipulate signals, and then I will show some circuits which you can use, in different dimensions. With different behaviors of filters, and you can set them up and use them. So, a small repetition, what is a voltage? It's work that has to be done to move charges from one point to another in our circuit. So, I don't want to talk about the physics deeply, but we have to know we get a voltage from this voltage source, and then it will go down over the rest of the circuit. And some notation, and you see sometimes this ground symbol on circuits, and that is a reference point. There, the voltage is always zeros. If you measure the point from there to there, from that point to that point, then it's always zero, and the other voltages are also reference to that point, and that's helps with the analyzation. If you say the voltage at that point has that and that voltage, and then you have that for the difference between these two points, and sometimes if it gets more complicated, you can leave the blue line out, and then everywhere where you have this ground symbol always painted in, but and there are two different symbols at two different points in the drawing, but they are the same point, so we can measure the voltage over a component over or between a point to ground. And another thing, so you have seen I used before the left one with the line in the middle, which goes through. That,
Symbole. Ich werde hier das rechte verwenden.
Then the voltage doesn't change, but that's DC.
Meinen, dass das eine,
and I will use the right one. And that's in this talk, it's a signal source, so the voltage changes often, and the voltage over time is something we can show in a diagram, and that's our signal.
Ein ganz einfaches
and
Signal
that's then
ist
what we use for to transmit information.
Wenn man dann die
so, a very easy signal is the sign. If you measure also the voltage there, then it would be changed like this. It would start at zero, go up to one, fall back down to minus one, go back up to one, and it's periodical. And I prepared something which would look like then this. You would have a circuit like this, and you see the voltage here in the colors which changes, and in the diagram you also see the value from up there to ground. The sinus frequencies have very different different ways, and it can have a different frequency or it can have a high or low amplitude, and
und zwar ein Rechteck.
You can do some nice things with it. And another signal here, it's a square wave, so it's like technical informatics. So it's for zeros and ones to code them. And I don't really mean that here. We don't interpret the signal, we don't do interpretation of it. And we are just looking how it looks, and and the other part we are not doing in this context. And I could have shown a triangle one, a triangle wave, or I just chose rectangular wave.
So I also drawn this in the simulation here. So we see that the voltage changes immediately, and so we get the square wave here.
Jetzt wird's spannend. Jedes Signal, das uns so
im
Wald und Wiesen.
Now it's getting interesting. Every signal we encounter here typically can be shown as the sum of different sinus waves. Technically as a sum of infinite number of sinus waves. Here I've plotted this here. So the blue signal is the it's stopped after two iterations, two summations. The yellow one after 6 and the green one after 34 add-ons. And the red one, very close to the actual rectangle wave. This is after 258 sine waves, summing up 258 sine waves. So we can basically do this for any kind of wave, for sawtooth waves, for triangle waves. And so if we look at that, we see that we do the plot versus the frequency here. Which sine waves can be found at which frequency? And with this simple example of a sine wave, we know that it only consists of one sine wave here. So here with 200 Hz and the amplitude of 1 volt.
So with a
square wave, we can create this by summing up lots of different sine waves, and this is plotted here. So here we see that we see a very low frequency sine wave with an amplitude of a bit more than 1.2 volt, and that's what you see here. And you see that it's the total amplitude is a bit more than 1.2 volts, and we can do cool things with that, because we can now construct filters that that attenuate certain sine waves and amplify other sine waves here. So this diagram here is what we call the spectrum of a signal. This is a different way of showing the same signal, but it contains the same information as looking at the time axis here. So that's the basics. So how do we manipulate signals, and what do I mean with that? So what we've learned, that a signal consists of all these different sine waves here, and then I'll play some music. That's lots of sine waves being added up, and well, there are low ones among them, and especially the low ones are those that travel through walls. And so the low ones are the in our case, we want to filter out the low frequency sine waves from that one. So how do we do this? So as I said, we put something in between here. But before, we want to have a look at how this signal could look like. So I've put a very simple version of that. Technically, this microphone cable is a lot more complicated. So basically, we have a signal source here and some single receiver, and between that we have a simple cable. Simple pair of wires. And so here in this case we have one. One wire, that's the ground, and another wire that contains the signal. So if you measure the voltage between the red one and the blue one, you get a voltage signal that contains information, for example, the sound. So this, well, we can have multiple that are shown red. So for example, if you have two, you could can get a stereo signal through that, but right now we are only looking at the simple source. So we cut this open, and between that we put some electric circuit. So this circuit is what we call an LTE filter. What's that? An LTI filter is a it's something much more general. It's some electrical circuit taking an input signal here as U in. That's a voltage we see at these two connections here, and outputs a manipulated value out. So this U out here. LTE meaning linear time invariant. I'm going to show what linear means later on. But let's show later how this works here. So we putting one signal in and another signal gets out here. So in this case, it's an attenuated, and we could get other signals that just passes through, so factor of one, or you could get signals in and which gets amplified here. So, for example, you can put sine waves in, that gets amplified here. So, which one are and which are not depends on the frequency. So, it could be that, well, it also depends on the system. So, there could be systems that... some signals we have a high frequency, some have a low frequency. We have there are what we call high passes, which do not filter out the high pass. So there's low passes. So there are two more words here. So two more ways. This is the homogeneity and the additivity. So the homogeneity meaning if I scale up the input signal, then the output signal gets amplified by the same factor. The input signal has the same frequency as on the bottom than above, but just a higher amplitude, then the output signal has the same frequency but different amplitude. The other interesting thing is the sum. So if I add two input signals, or I show this here, then the output is also the sum of the answers of these two systems. So we can't even just put sinus waves in, but we can also put square waves in or anything else. That's just that you can create by summing up sinus waves. So what we also want to describe how these this kind of LTE systems behave. So we know that there are low passes and high passes, but there are quite a couple of others that I want to show here. So we can describe this by the transfer function. This is the attenuation, so the amplification factor depending on the frequency. And omega is the circular frequency here, which is the frequency of the sine wave multiplied by 2 pi. And if the input is a sine wave with one frequency, it gets a different amplification than the one as from another frequency. And so we can plot this function over the frequency. And what we see here is that low frequency gets suppressed, and with higher frequency gets amplified or just pushed through.
Wollen wir den bei so einem Tiefpass oder bei einem Hochpass generell?
So we have one problem.
Konkret sagen
können, we want for a high pass or low pass filter, we want to have to say exactly up until that frequency it lets pass or it amplifies or it attenuates. So this graph doesn't have corners, so we don't really have see a critical frequency here. So and what we are doing here, we are drawing the asymptotes, the straight lines, which go closely to the function in the infinity, which are shown down, which I show here, and where they overlap, and then we are drawing a line down, and then where it happens, that's our critical frequency, which is one for us, which I made it easy for myself, and our transmission function comes here without a derivation, and it's j omega over 1 over omega j j omega plus 1, and we are not going to derivate it here. It's important that it looks like this, and later we can vary omega g with in our circuits, and later we are just having simple equations where we put our values in, and then we get our transmission function, and we don't have to think about a transmission function. But I want to show you so you know where it comes from. And there are also different filters which have different transmission functions. Here it's a high pass, and there are also a band pass, which attenuates high and low frequency and just lets the frequency in between pass or amplifies it. And this filters can also be can be implemented in electric circuits. And in the following, I want to show you the low pass and the band pass and the most and a very easy filter, the amplifier. And here you see a low pass filter, and it lets low frequencies pass, and lower frequencies get attenuated. Here you see the asymptotes again, and here's again the critical frequency, and the transmission function is similar as before. It's 1 over omega g j omega plus 1. And here is the bandpass filter. It attenuates low frequencies and it attenuates high frequencies, and in between it lets the frequencies pass. And we are drawing the asymptotes here, and then we are seeing the critical frequencies here, and we have two critical frequencies, omega 1 and omega 2. And in reality, if we were working with actual audio signals, they are actually higher than here, but here it's only about the concept. And our transmission function is j omega over 1 over omega 1 j omega plus 1 times 1 over omega 2 j omega plus 1. And you can Imagine that you put a high pass and a low pass filter, just you put them after each other. And the high pass attenuates the low frequencies, and the low pass attenuates the low frequencies, and everything in between gets passed. And the amplifier is a really easy filter, and it amplifies all the amplitudes independent of the frequency, so there is no critical frequency, and it has an amplifying factor of k in this time. Here it was 10. And so, what did we learn? Well, we know we have different ways how to look at voltages, which is especially important when I show the images of the circuits, where I look this, where I will use this ground symbol, and we have signals. And we can show our signals as the sum of assigned frequencies, which have a different amplitude for each frequency. And then if you add them up, you get that signal. And with LTE I filters, you get you can amplify or attenuate these frequencies. And the temp depends on the frequency of these. So our old goal was to filter a signal, and our new goal is to build a circuit which follows this transmission function. So we are designing filters. So at first, I want to show you two components. We know is a resistance. The resistance follows the equation U. The resistor follows the equation U equals R times I. So the voltage over the resistor is the value which is written on it times times what flows through it. And so if you have a capacity, then it's like an ideal capacity. And then at first we had a capacity, and then we don't just write UC equals C times IC, but we write 1 over J omega C times IC. And where there's a dot, because we're calculating with imaginary complex numbers, and I don't have the time to go into that. And yeah, that's where the J omega comes from. And we will see it later in the transmission function. And that's where we get the transmission function from. So after the R, we have here 1 over omega C. And when we have a resistor and a capacity serially, we don't have R plus C, but R plus 1 over J omega C. And another thing is the operational amplifier, where we have two inputs, one inverting and one non-inverting input, which are quite like that. And we have also a voltage plus, it's an example with plus V and minus plus V, the minus plus and once we are also connecting it with ground, and that's where our signal comes out. And then after the then it depends a little bit how you're doing it, and it works a little bit differently. And we are just using it once, and then it just at first works like we wanted, and it helps us filtering signals, and I will show it to you. And
okay, in the circuits I'm going to show, the other parts which are crossed out here will not be shown, but in practice they are there. So this makes it a lot easier to actually draw this this one here. So in reality, if you use such an operation amplifier, you are going to need those voltages, these connections. So this means that you have a look at a certain number of things, but I'm going to mention this later on. So in a typical OP. That you can order where your electronic parts would be an LM358, but you can take other that. So if you find this any others, have a look at the data sheet and see whether they fit your needs. So what we need here to design a filter is the inverting OP circuit, which looks at fault. So we have the OP here, we have the signal source here. This signal is delivering the input voltage going into this resistor here in the first branch here, which is connected to the inverting input of the OP. The non-inverting input is connected to ground here, and the output is connected to R2 with the second resistor, which is also connected to the inverting input here. So we are picking up the output voltage here, which is our output signal here. So if we want to actually wire this one, so we're putting a wire here, one wire here, and to ground, we put this into our cable, and that's our filter. This filter here is, as shown here, is just an amplifier. So it doesn't filter anything yet, but later we are going to show filter circuits that do filter, because we place this resistor here with either serial or parallel connections of capacitors. So for each of these the circuits, by now I'll derive the transfer function. Also derive the amplification factor in the non-attenuated area and the cutoff frequency. So independent of what the factor is, this amplifier looks like that. So the transfer function is minus R2 divided by R1, which is, this is because if you analyze this one, but I'm going to not do that, but let me just sketch this here. So you write a minus, you write a fraction, and on the top you get this the resistor on the coming from the output, and on the denominator you get the resistor from the input. So let me show this here. So this one here is an amplifier. We have three kilo ohm here, and 1 kilo ohm here, so the amplification factor is minus 3 here. We see this here, 5 volts input, and the output is 50 volt output here. So it works.
Jetzt gucken wir uns mal Hochpass an.
So.
Der Hochpass, der hat in der vorderen Kante.
So let's have a look at our high pass here. So high pass has in the first branch here a serial circuit from a capacitor and a resistor, and in this branch here it's just a resistor. So this is the transfer function. The amplification factor is again R2 divided by R1, and the cutoff frequency, see the formula here. So have a look at this one here.
Jetzt sehen wir,
so this is at 16 Hertz.
Das Eingangssignal ist 5 Volt.
So let me turn up the frequency.
Also das Ausgangssignal ist jetzt 4,62 Volt.
So we see the input signal is 5 Volt and there's almost no attenuation here. So almost 5 Volt here. But this is a high pass, so high frequency are not being attenuated, but lower frequencies will be attenuated. So let's turn down the frequency here. We see that the amplitude gets smaller. So the amplitude is just jetzt about a little less than 1 volt here, or even though the input is 1 volt here. And that's our high pass here. So if you have a look, if you want to build, if you design a high pass, you just take this circuit here. You have to commit to one of these components. So for example, if you have a 1 kilo ohm resistor, you set R1 to 1 kilo ohm, and Then you design which amplification effector you want to have. So let's say it's supposed to be 1. So R2 needs to be 1 kilo ohm as well. Then you write this down, and then you do some simple math there, and you might be getting some. If you have a capacity like that, you can start with that. If you don't, and if have some others, then you maybe have to tweak the other values as well to get to the same one. So how do we get this formula here for this transfer function, this one here? So with the inverting amplifier, we have the feedback branch divided by input branch. So the feedback branch here is R2.
Das heißt, wir schreiben auf.
The first branch, the input branch, is a serial series circuit from R1 plus the 1 divided by J omega C1. So now we do some magic math here, multiplying by A1. So the
J omega C1.
So we can move things around here.
Fliegt uns dieser.
So that's the formula that we get here.
Und da steht hier J omega C1 mal R1 plus 1.
So, and that's the formula we get here.
Das machen wir jetzt mit dem Tiefpass.
So, and we are doing something similar with the low pass as well.
Und die Sinusschwingung.
So we see that we remember up to the corner frequency, up to the cutoff frequency, we lets everything through and. Above that, it attenuates. So, and that's how this looks like here. So, in the feedback branch, we have a parallel circuit from a capacitor and a resistor, and the input branch we have just a resistor, and that's the formula we get from that. Same attenuation factor, same amplification factor, same again here, and cutoff frequency as well. So let's have a look at the simulation here. So again, that's a low pass, meaning low frequencies are not getting attenuated. So the input signal 5 volt, output signal 4.8, and now we turn up the frequency, and so if we increase the frequency, the amplitude should get smaller, and we see that this actually happens. So our low pass also works. So again, depending on which frequency, you have to modify these three components here. So the amplification function you can again derive like that. So this is the feedback branch and this is the input branch. Same formula here. So the parallel circuit looks like that. And then again, lots of math. Or not lots of math, a little bit of math, and we're getting to the same formula here. And that's the transfer function that we get here.
Jetzt haben wir noch einen Bandpass.
Wir sind jetzt allerdings etwas faul. Now we are having the bandpass, but we're just a bit lazy. We have a low pass and we have a high pass, so we make it, so we plug a high pass into a low pass, and then we have here these critical frequencies, 10 to the power 0 and 10 to the power 2. Then we are taking a high pass filter with the critical frequency of 10 to the power of 0, and we have lower frequencies damped, and our high pass, our low pass dumps everything above that critical frequency. So we just plug our two circuits we had before together. We have our amplification factor, which is just the both of these amplification factors multiplied for each other, and the critical frequencies are those of these Fermat circuits. And when we're looking at it here, and we have a very low frequency here, and then we're seeing it's 4 hertz, and then we have, and now we are making the frequency a bit higher, that was too much. So now we are make it higher, we are the signal isn't as damped and as before, and we are in the area where the signal gets passed through, and when we increase the frequency again, we are seeing again that the amplitude of the signal is dampened, and that's exactly what we want.
Verschiedene Schaltungen hintereinander geschaltet,
and, die wir uns yeah, überlegt haben. That's what that succeeded with plugging two different circuits after each other. And let's think what was the most important. We have a signal which consists of a sum of multiple sinus waves. Depending on their frequencies, they have different amplitudes. Then we can design circuits which work like LTI systems and which amplify certain frequencies or dampen others. And then we have a Bode diagram which shows that behavior.
Auch noch sehr viele andere Schaltungen.
And this filtering behavior we can do in a circuit. And there are really many different ones with different critical behaviors. It's a really easy design which we have here, but I think it's for trying around, it's really nice. And yeah. Something, there are some things we shouldn't not talk about. A real operational amplifier is not ideal. We have two things which are might be really a bit annoying. So it starts to damp at a certain frequency, and you can see it in its data sheet, and it doesn't. Dampens then everything, and the voltage which goes out. And you see it needs a voltage to work, and the output voltage can't be higher than that voltage. So if you have an input signal of 5 volt and we want to apply we want to amplify it by the factor of 10, so we should get 50 volts, but if we have a real one which has a 5 volt supply voltage, and then our signal doesn't get higher than 5 volts and we get rectangular waves, that might be nice for some overdrive effects, but if you want to send some signals, it's not really nice. Yeah, that was everything about the op-amp. And if you want to talk directly to a speaker, it probably doesn't work with that one, and there are other amplifiers which you can use for that, and with power amplifiers which you put after the op amp, and then the power is amplified, and then you can hear it through a speaker. And in the last slides, I put some interesting links in there. And there's also a YouTube video linked of someone who did that. And if you're thinking about the health of your signal source, because it might break, then you should put a non-inverted amplifier in there, and you can look it up on the internet. It's not more complicated than what we've done here. And there is some current flowing back. If you have something non-inverting amplifier, then there won't be any current flowing, but the voltage is still transmitted and the signal source is protected. The images of the circuits were generated with falstat.com. That's nice for small projects and how it looks. And there are other tools, and if you want to do it more professional, there is LTSpice, which is an analysis tool which does something similar as falstat, but it's more efficient and it's not a program on the web.
eine Python-Bibliothek zum
Nutzen. Yeah, that works really well.
Plotten vom Bodeplotz ist Python Control.
And, and the Python library is also with Python Control you can plot Bodeplotz, and there are also other libraries, but those are, it doesn't really restrict you on your transmission functions. And yeah, filestart.com I already said, and PySDR is something more about signal manipulation. How does it look? How can you control it? Learn Electronics is something on YouTube for trying around with this, and there's something, some really nice videos. And this video is something how you do it.
Links, also Bastelanleitungen, eine Rechenanhilfe.
And here is some more literature, some more links, some some how-tos, some calculating helps for high and low pass. And I just have to say to you, very much fun. Yeah, there will be a round of questions later, and you can ask questions and have fun.
Also,
yeah, thank you very much, Jakob, for this really interesting talk.
Von daher.
So I never learned something, learned that much about analog technique. So thank you, I could learn a lot. Now we are going to the questions and answers. And for those of you who have questions and hadn't posted them somewhere, please write them into the IRC hackend, into the channel RC3-FM, into the RC3 Rocket Chap, into the channel FEM, or on Twitter or in the Fediverse under the hashtag RC3FEM without the dash. Let's start with the questions. We have a question, which was supposed to the
geguckt auf Wikipedia.
What does a Wiener Filter has to do with a filter?
Okay, so I looked at Wikipedia before that one. So a Wiener Filter is, or Wiener Bridge, it's a certain kind of electrical circuit, and there, I mean, can do something with electrical filters there, but I don't really know. In my university courses, it was always in the context of we'd like to know something, and we use these kind of bridges, but you can certainly use this for filters as well.
Is it like a bridge circuit? Is it something from my StDR bridges, and then you have
yes, exactly. That's what this is, and you can use this with filters as well. Or I don't know any examples, but we can probably do that.
Well, next question. About the slide 56, what do you recommend against clipping?
So I hope you know the lab amplitude that's coming from the source. So for example, you know that's at most 10 volts or whatever you have here there, and then you need to make sure that the supply voltage for the OOP is well choose that across way. So you know the input might be 5 volts, and we say that we supply it with plus minus 5 volt or maybe a bit more. So to have some buffer there, some reserve there.
Next question. So it looks, that's not a question, that's just a comment. Here was the wish that you would explain the bandwidth for the bandpass.
So bandwidth is, so the bandpass has two critical frequencies, and the upper frequency, F2, minus the lower frequency, F1, and this is the bandwidth then. So the difference between the two critical frequencies. So that could be the definition.
So next question. Yeah. How much would it how useful would it be to decouple the low noises from the walls and the ground, and maybe let it hang from the from the from
okay. There's I don't know much about that. That's not my expertise here. So the thing with the microphone and karaoke, this is more like motivation for this talk here. So we have an audio signal, we want to filter that, and that's where I jumped right into the discussion. But if there's more about PA technique, well, then you would have to look into that.
Then there's a question about the images of the circuits, and why you have another dot on one of the ground. I think it was the slide where there was additional ground in there, which would just went to the to a dot, which didn't go on further.
Okay.
I think
you meant the slide. You meant the slide where there were several ground symbols. And as I said in the talk, so if you have some standard circuit diagram, like you know from school, without these symbols here. So you consider one point there to be the your reference, and that's where you draw the ground symbol there. And you can also draw this on other points as well. And if you do that, you say that these points are connected, or meaning the same point there. And this makes the circuit this simplifies the circuit this representation of the circuit.
Yeah, there's another question. Why don't you do it directly in software? Why would you do it as a physical circuit?
Yeah, because it's fun. Well, I thought this talk would make a lot of sense for people who solder a lot, who like to create physical things a lot, and that's why I started this with analog filters. So if you want to do this with digital filters, well, go ahead. You can do that.
Yeah. Another question from locally about the high-pass filter. There we had directly after the input signal, there was a capacity and a resistor, and the resistor, which was in the feedback branch, it has the same value as the first one, which would lead to an amplification of one. Can you not just leave the op amp away?
Yeah,
that doesn't the capacity do everything here now?
Es kann aber trotzdem sein, dass man
no. It could be that you still want to amplify. So for example, you could put a variable resistor there, which you can then use to increase or lower the amplification factor, turn the volume to 11. And there could be some other effects in there, but I would have to check here. So there's also the so there are passive high passes, passive low pass, passive or passive low passes, which is just combining capacitor and a resistor. But they have a couple of downsides, so we'd have to check the literature for that.
There's a really new question now here, and do you do it just for fun, or was it part of your studies?
Okay, so this was part of my university courses. I thought this is a topic that's cool and that's easy to create some slides here, but it's so, but there's not that much media for that. So basically the knowledge I presented here is coming from several different courses there, and I just wanted to give you the kind of summary for this for building filters here.
Ja, ansonsten.
So it's from my university courses.
Und zwar möchte ich
und so We have a small comment here in this list. Somebody want to recommend the YouTube channel Soundfile about acoustics in rooms, and there was something on the RC which frequencies do you want to attenuate. There was a discussion about that, and yeah, there was a comment that it depends how this your room actually look like. Yeah, then, at last, another question in this list, two questions. What would be necessary to choose the frequency when the filter attenuates a lot? You have some a knob you can turn around where you can choose.
Okay, so, but what I meant was,
diese Grenzfrequenz,
das so you have the OP filter,
and the
critical frequency of that one. This is only depends on the actual component. If you want to have a higher critical frequency of the OP, you need a different one, which is higher. Cut-off frequency.
Im Schaltungsaufbau kann man die Frequenzen nicht variabel einstellen, zum Beispiel am Potentiometer oder so.
Ach so. So it means you can't put it variable in.
Ah, wait.
Ach so. Okay, ich habe die
Frage. Let me check the question.
Ja, also.
Ah, okay. I got the question wrong.
Man nimmt sich die Formel.
So it's about critical frequency, not cut-off frequency. So.
Und dann nimmt man sich
so you have a look at the formula. Fp is this by that. So you take one of these two components, either the C or the R, and makes it a variable. So, for example, there are variable resistors, but there are also variable capacitors. So we can change the capacity there. And if you take one of those two in as the variable variant, then you can change them. But you have to be careful, of course, that you don't change the amplification factor at the same time.
So or you have to. Yeah. Could.
Okay.
This can become compensated.
Ja. Ansonsten auch noch eine Frage, die ich mich vorhin gefragt habe. Wieso benutzen
wir so? Another question, which I also ask myself, why do I use the inverting input and not the non-inverting input? Why do we have to invert the signal?
So two basic circuits on how you can use the OPV. Well, maybe a bit more, but there two are very important. So there's the inverting circuit and the non-inverting one. The non-inverting looks a bit different, and so the feedback also goes to the negative one. The voltage source is different. So the reason why we're using this one here is the transfer function gets the formula for that one gets relatively simple, and we can realize this function in a rather simple way, because you just basically just divide the feedback loop by the input loop, the feedback branch by the input branch, for the other.
So it's just to don't have to add calculation.
So with this simple filters, it's just three components, two resistors, one capacitor, and that's it. With that one of these basic circuits.
Then let's see. Yeah, there is one question.
Die man ja aus den gleichen Komponenten bauen kann.
Do you?
Also ich. Habe von
there are some thoughts about analog computers. Do you have some?
Okay, so I've heard about analog computers only from some fellow students of mine. So I have never worked with those. I have never done with anything. But I know that with OP, you can implement mathematical operations. Well, there's the non-inverting and the inverting circuit, but there are their addition or subtraction circuits with those. So you take the, so you have two inputs and you either subtract or add these two, and you can use this for, I think you can use this for analog computers as well, but actually I have never really thought about those in detail.
Okay. Yeah. Otherwise, I see no more questions in the list. And
yeah.
In the IRC, there's also nothing more. Yeah. Then I want to say thank you very much for this, for the answering the questions and for this really interesting talk. Yeah, and that was it for today. That was generally the last talk on the FEM channel. Thank you all those, thanks to all the listeners and to the whole audience who are looking and watching. So there's only the C3 news show at midnight. So let's see, we will see tomorrow the other news shows. And until then, thank you very much for watching. Thank you for your attention also from the translation booth. You have just heard the talk, designing filters for voltage signals, and it was translated by Isegrim and Carlo Ira. If you have feedback for us, please use the hashtag C3Lingo on Twitter or Mastodon.